Okay, today is 14th of August. We are still on the 35th chapter of Saṅkhita Nikāya, Salayatana Saṅkhita. Now we come to Sutta 35.231. The Buddha said, monks, in regard to forms cognizable by the eye, if in any monk or nun, lust still exists and has not been abandoned, if hatred still exists and has not been abandoned, if delusion still exists and has not been abandoned, then even trifling forms that enter into the range of the eye obsess the mind, not to speak of those that are prominent. For what reason? Because lust still exists and has not been abandoned. Hatred still exists and has not been abandoned. Delusion still exists and has not been abandoned. Similarly, for sounds, smells, taste, touch, and thoughts. Stop here for a moment. So here the Buddha is saying that if we have lust, hatred, and delusion within, that any form comes before our eyes, they obsess the mind. We get obsessed by the form. Similarly, sounds, smells, etc. So even small forms, like trifling, unimportant forms also, once we notice it, and then we start thinking about it. So what more if they are prominent forms? That's why later you find the Buddha says not to pay attention. Then the Buddha says, suppose monks, there was a milk sap tree, an asata, or a banyan, or a pilaka, or an udambara, fresh, young, tender. If a man breaks it here and there with a sharp axe, would sap come out? Yes, venerable sir. For what reason? Because there is sap. Stop here for a moment. So here the Buddha says, if the tree has got milk sap in it, you break off any part of it, or you cut it, then the milk sap will flow out, just like rubber tree. We are very familiar with rubber tree. So you cut any part of the rubber tree, the milk sap will flow out. So too, monks, in regard to forms cognizable by the eye, even trifling forms that enter into the range of the eye obsess the mind, not to speak of those that are prominent. For what reason? Because lust still exists and has not been abandoned. Hatred still exists and has not been abandoned. Delusion still exists and has not been abandoned. The same in regards to sounds, smells, taste, touch, and thoughts. Monks, in regard to forms cognizable by the eye, if in any monk or nun, lust does not exist and has been abandoned, if hatred does not exist and has been abandoned, if delusion does not exist and has been abandoned, then even prominent forms that enter into the range of the eye do not obsess the mind, not to speak of those that are trifling. For what reason? Because lust does not exist and has been abandoned. Hatred does not exist and has been abandoned. Delusion does not exist and has been abandoned. Similarly, for sounds, smells, taste, touch, and thoughts. Suppose, monks, there was a milk sap tree, an asata, or a banyan, or a pilaka, or an udambara, dried up, desiccated, past its prime. If a man breaks it here and there with a sharp axe, would sap come out? No, venerable sir. For what reason? Because there is no sap. So too, monks, in regard to forms cognizable by the eye, even prominent forms that enter into the range of the eye do not obsess the mind, not to speak of those that are trifling. For what reason? Because lust does not exist and has been abandoned. Hatred does not exist and has been abandoned. Delusion does not exist and has been abandoned. Similarly, for sounds, smells, taste, touch, and thoughts. That's the end of the sutta. So, When the six sense objects impinge on our senses, how we react depends on how much of this lust, hatred, and delusion is within us. If you have strong lust, hatred, and delusion, then if the sense object is attractive, you will have lust for it. You have craving for it. And that craving gives rise to attachment, and that attachment gives rise to suffering. You want something, you cannot get it permanently, then you will have suffering. But on the other hand, somebody who has cultivated himself until lust, hatred, and delusion has been eliminated, then whatever forms, whatever sounds, etc., come into his attention, it does not affect him because he does not have the lust, hatred, and delusion. So it's very important that we, remove this poison inside us, these three poisons. So actually, the problem is not outside there. The problem is not outside, the problem is inside. Sometimes we think the problem is outside, because of this, because of that. It's not because of this and because of that out there. It's because of inside us. The next sutta, 35.232. On one occasion, the Venerable Sariputta and the Venerable Mahakotita were dwelling at Varanasi in the deer park at Isipatana. Then in the evening, the Venerable Mahakotita emerged from seclusion and approached the Venerable Sariputta. He exchanged greetings with the Venerable Sariputta, and when they had concluded their greetings and cordial talk, he sat down to one side and said to him, "How is it, friend Sariputta? Is the eye the fetter of forms, or are forms the fetter of the eye? Is the ear the fetter of sounds, or are sounds the fetter of the ear, etc.?" For the other six, for the other sense bases also. And Venerable Sariputta replied, "Friend Kotita, the eye is not the fetter of forms, nor are forms the fetter of the eye, but rather the desire and lust that arise there, in dependence on both, that is the fetter there. Similarly, the ear is not the fetter of sounds, nor are sounds the fetter of the ear, but rather the desire and lust that arise there in dependence on both, that is the fetter there. Similarly, for the other sense bases. Suppose, friend, a black ox and a white ox were yoked together by a single harness or yoke. Would one be speaking rightly if one were to say, the black ox is the fetter of the white ox, the white ox is the fetter of the black ox?" And Venerable Kotita said, "No, friend. The black ox is not the fetter of the white ox, nor is the white ox the fetter of the black ox, but rather the single harness or yoke by which the two are yoked together. That is the fetter there." And Venerable Sariputta said, "So too, friend, the eye is not the fetter of forms." And he repeated what he said, "Nor are forms the fetter of the eye, but rather the desire and lust that arise there in dependence on both, that is the fetter there. The ear is not the fetter of sounds, nor are sounds the fetter of the ear, but rather the desire and lust that arise there in dependence on both, that is the fetter there." Similarly for the other sense bases. "If, friend, the eye were the fetter of forms, or if forms were the fetter of the eye, this living of the holy life could not be discerned for the complete destruction of suffering. But since the eye is not the fetter of forms, nor are forms the fetter of the eye, but rather the desire and lust that arise there in dependence on both is the fetter there, the living of the holy life is discerned for the complete destruction of suffering. If, friend, the ear were the fetter of sounds, or if sounds were the fetter of the ear, this living of the holy life could not be discerned for the complete destruction of suffering." Similarly for the other sense bases. "In this way too, friend, it may be understood how that is so. There exists in the Blessed One the eye. The Blessed One sees a form with the eye. Yet there is no desire and lust in the Blessed One. The Blessed One is well liberated in mind. There exists in the Blessed One the ear. The Blessed One hears a sound with the ear. Yet there is no desire and lust in the Blessed One. Similarly for the other sense bases. In this way, friend, it can be understood how the eye is not the fetter of forms, nor are forms the fetter of the eye, but rather the desire and lust that arise there, independence on both, is the fetter there. Similarly for the other sense bases. That's the end of the sutta. So here, you see, for each sense base, if you take, for example, the eye, when you have the eye and forms come before the eye, then eye consciousness arises. And the coming together of the three, the eye, the forms, and the eye consciousness, is the making of contact. When there is contact, feeling arises. And if the feeling is a pleasant feeling, then there is craving for it. If the feeling is an unpleasant feeling, then there is aversion towards it. So our mind is moved by craving and aversion, depending on the object. And sometimes, if the feeling that arises is neither pleasant nor unpleasant, then the feeling, then there is no craving and no aversion. In fact, generally, people, if the feeling is neither pleasant nor unpleasant, then people become ignorant of it, not aware of it. The problem here is not the I. The problem is not the forms. The problem is the feeling that arises, giving rise to craving or aversion. So a mind that is untrained, undeveloped, it is moved by the external sense objects. The external sense objects either give you craving or give you aversion, leading to hatred. It's because that is an undeveloped mind. So it's very important to develop our mind so that whatever comes, impinges on our six sense bases, that we don't react in an unwholesome way, in an unskillful way. If we react in an unskillful way, for example, we crave for a beautiful form, then since you cannot have that form all the time, then suffering will come. If you realize the nature of the six sense bases, that everything is impermanent, there's no happiness to be found from clinging to anything, then you don't react, then you will not have suffering. So the desire and lust, that is the factor, that is the factor that binds us in samsara. The next sutta is 35.234. On one occasion, the Venerable Ananda and the Venerable Udayi were dwelling at Kosambi in Gosita's park. Then in the evening, the Venerable Udayi emerged from seclusion and approached the Venerable Ananda. He exchanged greetings with the Venerable Ananda, and when they had concluded their greetings and cordial talk, he sat down to one side and said, "Friend Ananda, in many ways the nature of this body has been declared, disclosed, and revealed by the Blessed One thus. For such a reason, this body is not self. Is it possible to explain the nature of this consciousness in a similar way, to teach, proclaim, establish, disclose, analyze, and elucidate it thus? For such a reason, this consciousness is not self." Stop here for a moment. So here, Venerable Udayi says that the Buddha has taught that this body is not self. But is it possible in a similar way to say, to explain that